I'm going to be highlighting some of the built-in functions that MATLAB has. First of all, there are a bunch of common functions that are built into MATLAB. Things like absolute value, square root, the signum function, which returns the sign of a value or an array, remainder, exponential, log is the natural log, log 2 is built in, that's the base 2, log 10, and others. And what I wanted to do was highlight these round, fixed, floor, and ceiling, because those are a little bit confusing. First of all, the difference between round and fixed is that round always rounds it up or down to the nearest integer. So anything that's 4.5 and above, for example, would go up to 5, and anything below 4.5 would go down to 4. Fixed just lops off any decimal places, and so the fix of 4.8 would be 4. So that's the difference between round and fixed. Now we have floor and ceiling. Floor rounds down to the integer that's below it. 4.8 would go down to 4. Ceiling rounds up towards infinity, so ceiling of 4.8 is 5. And I can do the same on negative numbers, so floor of negative 4.8 is negative 5. Ceiling of negative 4.8 just rounds it up, which is negative 4. So there's a difference between these four different functions. Next, we have the trig functions in MATLAB, and these are just the typical sine, cosine, tangent, and so on. There's one main difference and one sort of enhancement that MATLAB has, and that is we have sine d. Sine d does everything in degrees, so the inputs can be in degrees, everything else is radians. So that's kind of nice, so you don't have to convert degrees to radians. Next, we go into the array functions in MATLAB. So we have size. A lot of times size is used in conjunction with a vector. I'll show you this in a moment. Length, numl, which is the number of elements. We can generate different arrays of random numbers. And we also have randn. It generates random numbers according to the Gaussian or normal distribution. So for example, if I did rand of 5, that generates a 5 by 5 array of random numbers between 0 and 1. Rand 3, 4 would generate a random array between 0 and 1, 3 rows, 4 columns. And rand n 3, 4 would generate a 3 by 4 array of normally distributed random numbers. It has a mean 0, standard deviation of 1. I've created a new array now, A, and I wanted to show you how we can use the size function. So size of A, that will return the rows and columns. But oftentimes we want to actually use the output of size in some sort of iterations or calculations. So I could do something like n rows, n calls. That vector is going to be equal to the size of A. We have actually stored the size of that into these two variables, n row and n columns, because that is described by the vector that's output from the size function. Finally, we have a couple more array functions in MATLAB. You can take the minimum of an array. If you want to use that in conjunction with a vector, AB, MATLAB will return the location of that minimum in that array X. Same thing with max. We can do mean, median, and mode, standard deviation, variance, can actually create a histogram. And then we've got the sum, the product of X, and we have various sort functions. So these sort functions I wanted to highlight briefly because they are a point of confusion. I've created a vector A, which is just 1 through 10 in increments of 1. Next, I created a vector R, which is 10 random numbers. I can create sort of an augmented array, that's C, which is just A and R. And now I've declared a new array D, which is just sort of C. What sort does is it independently sorts every column in ascending order. So you can see that I've decoupled the different rows. So 7 is no longer with 0.2963. I can also set up something like a sort C. And if you put this descend in there, then it sorts everything descending. Next, put in sort rows of C. And what that does is it sorts C depending upon the first column. So it actually keeps the rows together. Okay, it doesn't independently sort the columns. It keeps them together. And then if I do sort rows C, 2, that will actually sort the rows by the second column. And in a lot of cases, you actually want to keep the rows together because you might have corresponding data. One last thing I want to show you is if you want to extract a column from an array, I've reiterated my D array here. Let's just say I want to pluck out the second column. You can easily do that by just doing AR, this is a new vector, is equal to D, and I have a colon here, comma 2. Because the first index in an array is rows, colon just means all. So I have all rows of column 2, and that is what results. And you actually will use these types of things a lot when you're working with arrays.